Let's start putting together all of our formula-based derivative skills. Suppose someone is modeling a phenomenon that has some oscillation going on, but then the amplitude of the oscillation is dying down, and they've come up with this model, maybe based on the data they have, of 1.7 e to the negative 0.38 t times cosine 2 pi t over 2.1 plus 2.4. So we should ask ourselves kind of what's going on with this problem. S of t would be the position, perhaps vertical position, and we might want the velocity. So we'd want to take the derivative. In taking the derivative of this, what would you do? We can see some expressions inside other expressions. So there's probably some kind of chain rule going on. There's one expression that varies with time times another expression that varies with time, so maybe product rule. So is this fundamentally a product rule problem or a chain rule problem? So take a sec to think about that. Well, a usual good guidance is kind of whatever the last operation you would do is in the order of operations of evaluating a expression. Here that would be the product of this part times that part. That's kind of the main kind of derivative rule you use, or the first one you use. So this is essentially a product rule problem with the chain rule embedded inside it. So what are our two products here? Take a minute to think about that. Well, I see this first part being an expression that varies with time, so we'll call that its own thing. We'll call that f of t equals 1.7 e to the 0.38 t, and we can see that's giving us our falling off of amplitude, and then we'd have our second expression that would be the oscillating that's going on, cosine of 2 pi t over 2.1 plus the phase shift of 2.4. So we've got kind of the two parts of our phenomenon here, the oscillation and the falling off amplitude. So let's go take a look at taking the derivative of this from a formula perspective. So here's the expression I have the way we had it in Desmos. It's more convenient for me to type it in kind of text format, so I've got that here. And I've also highlighted one part of the formula and another part of the formula that are my two factors for the product. Put them in different colors. The 1.7, you could include that with one factor or the other factor, or you could leave it out entirely and just multiply by it at the end. Here I've decided to put it in with the first factor. As long as you're consistent, it doesn't really matter within the problem. So we know we're going to use the product rule here, and let's remind ourselves of the product rule. F times g quantity prime equals f prime times g plus f times g prime. So we know we're going to need f prime and g prime. So let's write down what is f and what is g. So I'm going to be doing this in a really explicit manner, and in a later video we'll do it in a more streamlined manner. So that's f, and then let's copy this and say what is f prime. So what am I going to need here? I'm going to need the chain rule, so because I've got an expression like 0.38t inside another expression, like e to a power. So let's write down here what the outside function, or outer function, is 1.7 times e to the stuff, you could say. The inside expression is negative 0.38 t. And I'm going to put that in its own color, maybe kind of a lighter red, because it's still associated with this the red term, but it's a special part of the red term, so I'm putting it in its own color. So having written that, I actually want to say it's that whole thing prime. So now I can say again f prime of t, we can say it's d outer function times d inner function. So that would be 1.7 e to the negative 0.38t because the derivative of e to a power is e to that same power, and then times the derivative of the inner function. Derivative of negative 0.38t is just negative 0.38. So overall, we have that times negative 0.38 without the t. So then we'll do the same thing for the second term, the oscillation term. So we'll say g of t equals that, just to remind ourselves. And then what is g prime? Well, we have, once again, an inner function and an outer function. So the outer function is cosine stuff, you could say. The inner function is all this stuff on the inside. Frequency times t, and then plus the phase shift. So let's color that, again, still kind of a blue, but maybe a lighter blue. So what is the derivative of that inner stuff? Back here, I forgot a prime, sorry. So the derivative of the outer function cosine stuff, derivative of cosine is negative sine of the stuff, so we'll just copy the stuff, times the derivative of the inner stuff. And now what is the derivative of 2 pi t divided by 2.1 plus 2.4? Got to think about that. So let's do that as its own line on our work here. Well, 2 pi is a multiplier, so the constant multiplier rule says we can just copy it. The derivative of t is 1. And then what about the divide by 2.1? Well, we could use the quotient rule, but that would be the long way around. We can think of the time divided by 2.1 as times 1 over 2.1, like we've said before. So we could say times 1 over 2.1, treating it as a constant multiplier rule. Or we could say there's a constant dividing rule, just like a constant multiplying rule, and just copy that divided by 2.1. And then plus the derivative of 2.4. Derivative of 2.4 is 0 because 2.4 is a constant. So altogether we've got g prime t equals negative sine of the original inner stuff times the derivative of our inner stuff here. And we'll put that there. Except we'll leave off the plus zero, or we could put that whole expression in parentheses. So now we've got all the pieces assembled, and we've got all the pieces laid out, and we need to assemble the whole thing. So the velocity function, that's what we're going for here. Velocity at time t would be position prime at time t, which is, like we said, f prime times g plus g times f prime equals. So what do we have? We have our derivative of the f term, so that's that, times g, so the original expression for g, plus g times, just noticed I got this backwards, huh? So f times g prime. So we have to go get the original f function, so I'll copy that from here, times g prime, which we eventually figured out here, and there we go. So let's make it all fit on the same line. So what are we going to do with this now? Well, we should check it, maybe by putting it back into Desmos, and then also having Desmos graph the derivative for us. So I'll do that in just a sec. All right, here we are back in Desmos. I pasted in my big long expression. I had to turn the letters pi into the actual number pi. You can see there's a whole expression there. And then how will we check it? Well, we can ask Desmos to graph the its derivative based on difference quotients of the original position function. I'd tempted to say s prime of t, but Desmos doesn't know what to do with that, so it's easier to do s prime of x. And then we can turn the line invisible or visible, and we see that our by-hand expression for v matches Desmos' derivative for s prime, and we have successfully checked it. We can also check things like where the original function, which is the blue curve, has a local maximum, then the derivative function has a y value of 0. Where the original function has a positive slope to it, the derivative function, the red, has positive y values. So those are good things to spiral back on and check. In the next video, we will do a streamlined version of the whole derivative process.